Hello viewers and welcome to a complete tutorial and how to play guide for the Lord of the Rings the card game, which is a 1-4 player solo or cooperative living card game published by Fantasy Flight Games. My name is Mitch, and though I've recently come to be known as the Hive Tyrant, dedicated to producing content for the adversarial living card game Warhammer 40,000 Conquest, I previously spent nearly 2 years as one of the co-hosts of Cardboard of the Rings, a bi-weekly podcast dedicated to the coverage and discussion of LOTR LCG. Further, I was responsible for the creation of the tragically discontinued, now long defunct, 64-episode series of videos known as the LOTR LCG Progression Series. However, I'm delighted to announce that this video marks the restart and re-envisioning of that same series, and as the premise behind it was to replay and reassess each and every release and expansion for the Lord of the Rings living card game chronologically, starting from the very beginning with the core set, what better way to involve as many viewers and potential new players as possible than to begin with a how-to-play style tutorial. But just as Frodo could not have dreamed of reaching the cracks of Orodruin alone, today I have the honor of being reunited with a very old friend. So, Matthew, as we begin this new series of adventures in Middle-earth together, why don't you take a moment to introduce yourself?
Hello, viewers. My name is Matthew, and I am beyond thrilled to be back and filming progression series videos with Mitch. I also am currently a co-host on the Grey Company podcast, which is an in-depth Lord of the Rings LCG podcast focusing on strategy, deck building, and the metagame. Definitely looking forward to this tutorial video and certainly all of the fun content that we have in store, so I'm ready to get started.
Well, most definitely, I'm thrilled to be back at it, thrilled to have you as a co-host for our reboot of the Progression series. But Matthew and I have both introduced ourselves. I mentioned that this is a solo or cooperative game, so really, one of the first things you have to do when you sit down to play a game of the Lord of the Rings, the card game, is decide how many players you're going to bring. Since the players are either working independently or together as a team, you're going to be playing against an AI-controlled encounter deck. So you choose a scenario that you're going to be playing against, and what you bring to the table is a custom-built deck. So this is very much a deck-building game, and each different scenario kind of has a lot of unique elements that really make this almost into a bit of a puzzle for the players to work together to solve. My deck in this video, you'll note that I begin with three different heroes on the table, and each of the different heroes for the Lord of the Rings come from four different spheres of influence. Two of my heroes come from something called leadership, and each of these spheres has different elements that make it unique. It's got strengths and weaknesses that are kind of specific to that sphere. Leadership is good with giving you action advantage. It allows you to do more things during each game round. It's also great at increasing your number of available resources so you can fund more card effects, and it also has a large number of global effects that can benefit multiple characters. I also have a spirit hero, and spirit has an emphasis not on combat, which is definitely a heavy element of this card game, but it does something well called questing. And questing isn't quite as flashy, isn't quite as provocative or sexy, but it's essentially the way that players actually beat a given quest. And Matthew, how about yourself?
I also have heroes from two spheres of influence. One of my heroes is from the lore sphere, and that sphere basically excels at three things: card draw, healing, and encounter deck manipulation. My remaining two heroes come from the tactics sphere. This sphere is all about combat, whether it's defending enemies or killing enemies. This sphere excels at that.
So the reason I had Matthew and I introduce our heroes first is because when I sit down to build a deck in this game, I essentially just choose three heroes, and then the cards which constitute my deck are basically dictated by the heroes that I choose. So I've got two leadership heroes and a spirit hero. So for the Lord of the Rings, you build a deck of a minimum of 50 cards, and given my choice of heroes, most of my cards are going to be drawn from the leadership and spirit spheres of influence. There are also neutral cards, which don't belong to any sphere, and it's just important to keep in mind that during each game round, each hero's resources can only be used to pay for cards that belong to the sphere of influence, which match that hero. So Aragorn and Theodred here can pay for leadership cards, and Eowyn can pay for spirit cards. It's also worth noting that some cards cost zero resources, but they still require something called a resource match. So, if I have a zero-cost leadership card, even though it doesn't cost me any resource tokens to play it, I still have to have a hero in play with a leadership sphere of influence icon. So, even though I could conceivably include lore or tactics zero-cost cards in my leadership and spirit deck, because I don't have a hero with a lore or tactics icon, I have no way whatsoever to play them. But, especially as our card pool develops, we eventually start to see ways where you can grant additional sphere of influence affiliations to your heroes, and that makes this entire multi-sphere deck concept a much easier thing to actually execute upon. It's also worth considering that there are indeed neutral cards in this game, and when you attempt to play one of those, you can use resource tokens from a hero of any sphere of influence. So whether it's leadership, spirit, tactics, or lore, it doesn't matter at all. If it's a neutral card, so long as you can pay the requisite number of resources, then you can put that card into play. The individual constituents of a player's deck are allies, events, and attachments. So here's an example of an ally. They have statistics similar to a hero, and every character in this game has a willpower value, which you use to quest. They have a defense strength value, which you use to defend against the attacks of enemies, and they also have an attack strength value, which you use to dispatch enemies sent forth from the encounter deck. They also have a hit point value, which, you know, like if you take damage equal to your hit points, your character is destroyed, and then they have traits and abilities as well. There are attachments, which you can basically stick onto any of your characters to augment their natural abilities, and there are also events, which have powerful one-time use effects. One of the only rules to consider when it comes to deck building is that you can only have up to three cards in your deck with any given name. So I can have up to three copies of this card, Gandalf, in my deck, and seeing as how The Lord of the Rings, the card game, has been out for 5 years now, we've started to see a large number of duplicate characters. So there's the original version of Gandalf that I'm using in this core set only deck, but there's also a different version of Gandalf which was released later on, so I could use two copies of this Gandalf, one copy of the other, or vice versa, or a copy of each. You get the point. But with that said, I'll just go ahead and close my deck, and once Matthew and I have our deck selected, we have to choose a quest or scenario to face. For this video, we're going to be playing the very first quest, the introductory scenario, Passage Through Mirkwood. You can see we've got four quest cards sitting here on the table, and because Octagon, the virtual playing surface that we're using so that Matthew in Arizona and me in Washington State can actually sit down and play this game together, it's automated to the point where it begins our scenario with some steps already taken care of. But Matthew's got his tactics and lore deck, I've got my leadership and spirit deck, and let's run through setup. So, the first thing you have to do is shuffle your deck. So Matthew and I have both sat down, we ensure that our decks are randomized, because Octagon has automation built into it, we've already placed our heroes in front of us, and something else that we have to do is set our initial threat levels. So at the very upper left-hand corner of each hero card, you see a blue number. In the case of Eowyn, it's the number 9. You look at each of your three starting heroes, and I suppose just for the sake of mentioning it, it's possible to begin the game with one or two heroes instead of the usual three, just to ensure that your threat value is as low as possible, because eventually there is going to be a series of cards which reward players for keeping their threat below a specific point. So Eowyn has 9 threat, Theodred has 8. So 9 plus 8 is 17. If you add Aragorn's threat, it brings me to my total of 29, which you can see clearly illustrated in this box here. Matthew, I suppose, what about you? What is your starting threat?
I've got 10, 9, and 11, so my starting threat is 30.
Right. So as I'm sure you'll quickly learn, elementary school mathematics skills are very important to the Lord of the Rings, the card game here. But now that we've set our heroes, we've set our initial threat, which is going to come into play later, we also have to set the first player token. It's going to be Matthew for today's game, and over the course of every game round, there are 7 distinct phases. Generally, the player holding the first player token is going to be the first person to act during each phase, and whenever there happens to be some kind of dispute in regard to what order some card effects are resolved, or what location we travel to, which we'll talk about more in depth later, the first player is the ultimate deciding factor here. But we've done all that so far. Next, we just have to draw our opening hands. So I'm going to go ahead and right-click on my deck, draw mini cards, and I'm going to choose 6. So no matter what, in this game, you always draw an opening hand of 6 cards. And I'm not exactly thrilled with what I started with, but I definitely did happen to stumble upon a power card, so I think I'm going to go ahead and keep my opening hand. And what about you, Matthew?
Mine isn't all that great, so I'm actually going to take a mulligan.
All right, so, you know, once per game, you have an opportunity to take a mulligan. You essentially discard your hand, and you draw 6 new additional cards. Matthew and I, for this demo game, are both going to be playing with our hands readily visible to both you, the viewer, and one another. But, Matthew, what are your thoughts on your mulligan?
Probably worse than my opening hand, but those are the breaks.
Yeah, I guess you've kind of got to stick with it. Fortunately, yep. You've got Berevor to draw you some additional cards at some point. So, Matthew and I have drawn our opening hand, we've determined the first player, we've set our threat levels, placed our heroes. Next, we have to, you know, specific to each scenario, set out our quest cards. So, in The Lord of the Rings, you play through each quest in sequence, going through a number of different cards. There's card 1, card 2, and then for this first scenario, there's 3 different versions of phase 3, which is the third quest card. Each scenario has specific setup instructions, and that's going to be the final part of setup here. So we look at our very first quest card. It's quest card 1A. It reads, setup. Search the encounter deck for 1 copy of the Forest Spider and 1 copy of the Old Forest Road and add them to the staging area. Then shuffle the encounter deck. So Octagon's automation already took care of this for us, but we can see sitting out here in the staging area, we've got our Forest Spider. So Matthew and I placed our initial threat levels. Note that in the upper left-hand corner of this enemy, this Forest Spider, one of 3 different generic kinds of encounter cards, it's got a number 25. That means that if Matthew and I have a threat that is equal to or higher than that engagement cost, this enemy is basically going to come down from the staging area and it's going to be attacking us, trying to kill off our heroes. If at any point all of a player's heroes are killed, they lose the game. and the only other defeat condition is if a player hits a total of 50 threat. There are going to be a number of encounter card effects that increase threat, and at the end of every game round, a player also increases their threat. Speaking of threat, the next number moving on down, this encounter card is going to be the threat strength of the enemy. It's represented by like a spiky crown or a throne. In this case, it's 2, and over the course of each game round, we're going to be committing characters to questing, and we're going to have to send more willpower to the quest than there is total combined threat strength sitting in the staging area. That's the only way that we're actually going to be making quest progress in order to eventually win a scenario. The next number down with those double axes is going to be the attack strength of the enemy, how hard it hits, and then that shield reflects defense strength, kind of how durable the enemy is. The bright red number 4 is hit points, the number of damage this unit has to take before it's destroyed. You can see traits, creature and spider, and this forest spider also has an ability. It also has a shadow effect at the very bottom of the card, and that's something we'll talk about a little bit later on. Also, in the staging area, we have one location. That's another of 3 basic encounter card types, and the way that these locations work is they basically sit out in the staging area, they contribute threat, and once per turn, Matthew and I will have the opportunity to travel to a location. So just like an enemy, when it leaves the staging area, it no longer counts its threat against you. When you make a location into the active location, it no longer counts its threat against you. Sometimes there's a penalty for traveling to a location, like discard a card. Sometimes, which is exceptionally rare, but is the case with the Old Forest Road here, it actually gives the players a benefit to traveling to it. And locations buffer the current quest card, so when we quest successfully, when we commit more willpower to the quest than there is threat strength sitting in the staging area, we put progress tokens on the current quest. When it reaches a specified value of tokens, we can move on to the next quest phase, like phase 1 to phase 2, but a location basically sucks up a bunch of those progress tokens until it's explored. And until you get rid of your current active location, you cannot travel to another location. So, enemies you manage through combat, locations you manage through travel. But we've satisfied all the setup requirements of quest card 1A. Let's go ahead and flip it over to quest card 1B. This only has flavor text, but it's got that glowing number 8 that indicates we need to make 8 progress prior to being able to move on to quest phase 2. So, with much ado, we finally set up our game. We're ready for round number 1 and phase number 1, and the very first phase of each game is going to be the resource phase. We're going to go ahead and add 1 resource token to every hero in play. All the players do this simultaneously. And we also draw 1 card. So I drew this leadership event here. Right after the players have put a resource token on each of their heroes and each player has drawn a card, you have the ability to take any actions you would like, which, again, we'll talk about later, immediately prior to moving into the next phase of the game. So as soon as Matthew adds some resources to his heroes, we'll go ahead and move to planning. And because Matthew is going to be our first player, during the planning phase, he'll have the first opportunity to play any allies or attachments or take any actions he would like. So, Matthew, you've got a resource token on each of your characters. You've got access to a total of 2 tactics resources and 1 lore resource. I suppose, what from your hand are you interested in playing?
All right, well, let me draw my 7th card, because that is the first thing I need to do. So we draw 1 card per round, which, honestly, this card doesn't change much of what I want to do. I am going to place a weapon attachment onto Legolas.
Okay.
And that is actually all that I'm going to do.
Okay, so sometimes it's wise to hang on to resources just in case you have some events or actions you want to trigger during a later phase. Now that Matthew has passed on his planning, I've got the opportunity, the once per game round opportunity to play allies and attachments. And I think what I'm going to do is I want to pay two leadership resources to play a card called Steward of Gondor. This is an attachment. And the way that this works is I simply affix it to a character. In this case, it's going to be attached to Eowyn. She gains the Gondor trait, and I can exhaust this attachment to add two resources to the attached hero's resource pool. This is one of the strongest attachments in the game, because as an action, I'm going to use it currently, and I'm going to add two resources to Eowyn here. I want to spend two of those resources I just gained, and I'm going to go ahead and play an ally. I'm going to put a wandering toque on the table, so it functions very similar to a hero. In the upper left-hand corner of both of these cards, you can see the resource cost associated with them. So it was two leadership for Steward of Gondor, two spirit for wandering toque. It can quest for one, it can defend with one strength, and it can also attack. It's got an action where I can give it to Matthew, and he and I kind of adjust our threat levels, but I think with that said, I'm done with my own planning, and this is going to bring us to the next phase of each game round, which is the quest phase. So, the very first step is going to be committing characters to the quest. So, Matthew's got the first choice. Which of your characters do you want to commit?
I will send Gimli, who has 2 willpower, and Barrowfor, who has 2, for a total of 4. Once again, those elementary math skills coming into play.
Right. Okay, so he's going to send a total of 4. I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to be pretty conservative here. So now that Matthew has decided which of his characters he's commit to the quest, just notice that at present, they're turned to their side. This indicates that they're exhausted or knelt, and it basically indicates that they cannot take another action until they're no longer exhausted. So Gimli here can't defend. He's not going to be able to attack, and similarly, Barrowfor can't attack or defend or exhaust to use her ability. For me, I'm going to be committing all of my characters to the quest simultaneously, and I think I want to send each of my different heroes. Note that Theodred has a response that's going to be activating, so he reads, after he commits to a quest, I choose a hero committed to that quest. I add a resource to their resource pool. I'm going to go ahead and choose Aragorn as the target of that effect, and Aragorn has a response himself that reads, after he commits to a quest, you can spend a resource from his pool to ready him. So I determine the sequence in which these abilities trigger. Theodred gives a resource to Aragorn. Aragorn is going to head and spend that resource, and he's going to ready, and this is going to leave him ready to attack and defend. And even though he's currently ready, he's not exhausted like the other 4 characters currently commit to the quest, he does still count his willpower toward whatever the encounter deck is going to bring to bear against us. So Matthew sent a total of 4 between 2 characters. I'm going to send 2, 3 for a total of 7. Note that Eowyn has an ability where, as an action, Matthew and I both have the opportunity to discard a card from hand in order to increase her willpower. So if we're surprised by how much threat we have to go up against, we can kind of adjust our number of commit willpower accordingly, just to make sure that we can maybe clear an active location or progress to the next stage of a quest, and all sorts of stuff like that. We could even leave more characters unexhausted to participate in combat, in case we want to, you know, have Eowyn do the questing for multiple characters. But Matthew and I have sent a grand total of 11 threat to the quest at the end of the commit characters mini step of the quest phase. We've got another opportunity for actions. I don't think either of us are going to take advantage of that.
Nope.
So, are we ready for staging, Matthew?
Let's do it.
All right. So this is probably the most exciting part of the quest phase. You cannot take any actions, play any card effects, unless they're triggered in response to staging specifically. But staging is where the encounter deck kind of brings some new weaponry to bear against the players. So for each player in the game, whether it's 1, 2, 3, or 4, you're going to reveal, one at a time, that many encounter cards from the encounter deck. So, staging encounter card number 1 is going to be another copy of the Forest Spider, so note that it adds an additional 2 threat to the staging area. Encounter card number 2 is going to be a location. It's the Mountains of Mirkwood, so it's another 2 threat location. This one has a travel effect, but we'll talk about travel effects in just a moment. So, let's count up the amount of threat against us. At present, it's going to be 2, 4, 5, and a total of 7. So I'll go ahead and indicate that there's 7 threat against us. At present, Matthew and I are looking like we're going to be making 4 progress, but after staging, we have the opportunity to take any actions. So if Matthew and I wanted to, we could each discard a card to Eowyn and boost her willpower by 1 apiece. But at this point, I don't really think that that's necessary. Do you, Matthew?
I agree. Nope.
All right. So, I think we're good with that. We'll go ahead and skip past staging, and then the last step of the quest phase is going to be quest resolution. So we compare our total willpower, 11, to the total combined threat strength in the staging area, which is 7, and we're going to put the difference in quest progress on our current quest. So we've got 4 out of the 8 required quest points. Before we move on, do bear in mind that the quest phase is never optional. So, while the players may not have, or may choose not to commit, sufficient willpower to the quest in order to overcome the amount of threat that ends up in the staging area, they always have to at least attempt to quest. If, during quest resolution, the players end up sending less willpower to the quest than there is threat sitting in the staging area, then each player adds that difference to their total threat value. For instance, if the players commit a total of 5 willpower worth of characters to the quest, but there's a total of 10 threat sitting in the staging area, then each player has to add a whopping 5 to their total threat value. And considering that a player is eliminated from the game the instant that they hit 50 threats, if you continually fail to quest successfully, that definitely spells disaster in rather short order. Plus, when players do fail to quest successfully, that tends to be the trigger for a wide number of rather nasty and deleterious quest and encounter card effects. The next phase is going to be our travel phase. We've got 2 locations in the staging area, and we get to choose one of these to travel to. So the Old Forest Road, if we travel there, it only removes 1 threat from the staging area. If we go to the Mountains of Mirkwood, we're going to be removing 2 threat from the staging area, but to make that the active location, we have to reveal another card off the top of the encounter deck, and it might be another enemy, and Matthew and I, because our threat values are higher than the engagement cost in the upper left-hand corner of these enemies, we know that we're going to have to engage in some combat this turn, so I vote we move to the Old Forest Road.
I agree with you there.
All right, so we're going to go ahead and make that the active location. It's moved toward the quest deck here. It's out of the staging area, and it's got a response where when you travel here, the first player can choose and ready a character they control. So who do you want to ready, Matthew?
Let's do Gimli.
Okay. So Gimli can ready, and just for the sake of tossing some information out there, Matthew, do bear in mind I can cancel any shadow effects in case you feel like being ballsy and doing an undefended attack.
Okay, sounds good.
But that's some complexity we'll be touching on shortly. So after the travel phase, the fourth phase of the game, we move on to the encounter phase. It's broken down into a couple distinct steps, the first of which is called optional engagement. experiment. Let's say I'm a really squishy, vulnerable deck that has all exhausted characters. I can't really defend, I can't do much to destroy any enemies, and Matthew is actually much more formidable. He can handle far more enemies than I could ever hope to. And as our card pool gets bigger and bigger as we move beyond the core set, do note that these are core set only decks, the specialization that Matthew and I are going to exhibit is probably only going to become all the more intense in time. But optional engagement means if an enemy is going to be going down to attack me, like if my threat is higher than its engagement cost, another player can optionally engage with that enemy and basically pull it over to their side of the board so that they have to deal with it in combat, so I don't. In this case, we can do things a number of different ways. So you're first given that choice of optional engagement, but then after you do that, you do step two, which is called engagement checks. The way that that works is starting with the first player, you find the highest engagement cost enemy in the staging area, and you compare its engagement cost to the first player's threat. If the threat is equal to or higher, that enemy engages, and then you switch to the other player, and they do the same thing. So they look for the highest engagement cost enemy, compare it to their threat. If there's no eligible enemy, you keep going through enemies, working from high engagement cost to low, until you finally find an eligible target. If you run out of enemies in the staging area, you of course stop. Let's say if my threat was only 20, and Matthew's is 30, like it currently is, he'd basically be forced to engage with both of these spiders. So he would do an engagement check, he'd have to engage with a spider, I would do an engagement check, there are no eligible enemies, then it would bounce back to Matthew, he'd do another check, and he'd get that forest spider. But what I think we might want to do is just do our engagement checks and have Matthew engage with one enemy, and then I can also engage with one enemy.
Okay.
So I'm going to go ahead and bring these forest spiders down to each of us because I've got a little bit of a sneaky plan for how we can deal with these. So let me think for just a moment. Notice that each of these forest spiders has an effect, and I'm going to put a quest progress on them, which is irrelevant to an enemy, just to indicate that they're currently under the influence of an action. In fact, why don't I just go ahead and highlight them here? So they've got a forced effect where it says after they engage a player, they get plus one attack strength until the end of the round. So this basically means that they're going to be attacking for three, albeit for a limited time only. Now that Matthew and I are both engaged with an enemy, we're going to be moving to something called the combat phase. And at the beginning of the combat phase, you deal a shadow card to all enemies engaged with players. And shadow card is just a term to refer to a card taken from the top of the encounter deck, which is put face down under an engaged enemy. So, in dealing out shadow cards, which happens one at a time, you start with the first player, you do all of their enemies, and you start with the highest engagement cost and work your way down. So I'm going to go ahead and deal a shadow card to Matthew's forest spider. I'm going to deal a shadow card to my forest spider because Matthew's run out of enemies. And then the next step is going to be defending. So in this game, you do all of your defenses and then you do your attacks. So Matthew, I suppose you've only got the one enemy engaged with you. You have to choose it, step one of defending, but which of your characters, if any, do you want to defend?
I'm going to take this attack undefended.
All right, so let's walk through two different scenarios. Your basic scenario is you declare a hero or ally as a defender. So the forest spider has an attack value of a total of three, and Matthew, if you would humor me, just go ahead and exhaust Gimli to represent that he is defending against this attack. So, just like committing a character to the quest, they're exhausted to indicate that they're defending, and in this case, we've got three outgoing attack, and Gimli has two defense strength, that shield icon there, so Gimli would take a single point of damage toward his five total hit points, but whenever an enemy attacks, it also has a shadow card, which could do nothing, or it could increase the enemy's attack value, or it could make you exhaust characters. It has a lot of different deleterious effects. Alternatively, and this is what Matthew is choosing to do in this circumstance, is he's taking the attack undefended. So when you're not defending against an attack, you don't need to exhaust your characters, so Gimli can remain standing to attack in return, and instead you just assign the attack damage to one of your heroes without the benefit of their defense strength. But a lot of shadow effects get a lot stronger if you take an attack undefended. So Matthew declares an undefended attack. Let's go ahead and flip this shadow card in the step three here. So it's choose enemy, declare defender. We said undefended. Step three is going to be resolve shadow effect.
Phew.
There is no shadow effect associated with this card. If the Forest Spider would have gotten another copy of Forest Spider as its shadow card, you can see at the bottom there it says defending player must choose and discard one attachment he controls. So Gimli is going to have to assign 3 points of damage because of that Forest Spider's forced effect there. Alright, and that's that. Now that Matthew's done his defenses, before he gets the opportunity to attack in return, I have to go ahead and do my defending. So in looking ahead, it's going to take a total of 5 attack to kill this forest spider. Gimli, at present, has 3 points of damage on him, so thanks to his ability, he's going to be able to attack for 5. And let's see, my Wandering Took plus Aragorn is not quite going to be able to kill this forest spider here. So I think I too am going to be a little bit ballsy, a little bit risky, and I'm also going to take my attack undefended. So I'm going to go ahead and flip the shadow card. It's nothing, and this is actually the third kind of encounter card which we've yet to see. This is a treachery. It's basically the encounter card's version of an event. It's a one-time effect which you use and resolve and then it's gone. But the forest spider is going to deal 3 points of damage to me. I'm going to go ahead and assign all of it to the same hero. I can't split it among my heroes. And now Aragorn is just sitting at lowly 2 hit points. And I suppose I'll just have to use my knowledge of what the encounter deck can bring to bear to help me make sure that he doesn't end up being killed. I mentioned earlier that this is very much like a puzzle game, just because the scenarios are always the same, so if you're having trouble playing against one, you can kind of customize and cater your deck, specifically hone it to beat whatever scenario you're going up against. But Matthew has defended, I have defended. Matthew, let's move on to the declare attacks step. So step one is declare the target of an attack as well as your attackers.
I am going to use Gimli to smash my spider.
Okay, so we can indicate with an arrow that Gimli is attacking that forest spider. There's no cute tricks now, it's just Gimli attacks for 2 plus 3 because he has 3 points of damage. The forest spider's defense strength soaks up 1, but it's going to end up taking 4 points of damage. Its damage is going to be equal to its hit points, so it's going to be immediately killed, and all associated shadow cards are going to be immediately discarded. The encounter card discard pile is public information in case Matthew and I ever want to check it and see what kind of nasty encounter cards we've already dealt with, but Matthew's destroyed all of his engaged enemies, and unless you have any additional attacks to declare, Matthew, I'll go ahead and do my attacks.
It is all you.
All right, so I'm going to go ahead and pool an attack, and we can demonstrate some pretty interesting stuff here. So I'm going to have my Wandering Took and Aragorn together attack the forest spider. They only have a total attack strength of 4, which is not quite enough to destroy this enemy. But
luckily, Legolas has the ranged keyword, So he is going to swing over and join your attack.
Right. So Legolas can also join in on that attack, and all of these characters are going to pool their attack values. So Legolas has ranged. That means he can participate in attacks declared by other players. So it's going to be 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 in total, minus 1 because of that defense strength, is still going to be 6 points of damage. 6 is, of course, equal to or greater than 4, and that means that Forest Spider is destroyed. And Matthew, you've got some abilities to trigger.
I do indeed. So Legolas has the ability, after he participates in an attack that destroys an enemy, we get to place 2 progress tokens on the current quest.
Right.
In this case, the active location would act as a buffer, so those 2 tokens will go on our old forest road. But I also put a Blade of Gondolin on him during my planning phase, which would give him plus 1 attack strength when attacking an orc, but that was a spider, so that didn't matter. But it also has a response, which is after my attached hero attacks and destroys an enemy, I can place 1 progress token on the current quest. So I actually get to place a total of 3.
Right, and 3 progress tokens equals the 3 quest points associated with the Old Forest Road, so that means our location is successfully explored, and just like those enemies were discarded, that location is going to be discarded as well. So, that's the end of combat. Matthew and I have got an action window if we want to do anything, but there's not really anything left to be done. Do note that Aragorn here, he has the Sentinel keyword, and just like Legolas, can use ranged to participate in attacks with other players or declare attacks against enemies engaged with other players. Aragorn can defend for other players. But, even though you can pool the attack values of multiple characters together to destroy one enemy, you can only declare a single defender each time an enemy attacks. But, Matthew, are we ready for our final phase of the round, that refresh phase?
Let's do it.
All right, so we hit Control R, all of our exhausted characters, attachments, and whatnot move to the refreshed or ready position. Our threat value automatically increases by 1, and do remember that Matthew and I are playing with a little bit of a built-in time limit, and that we have to beat this scenario before we each hit 50 threat, because the instant that a player hits 50 threat, you're eliminated, just like if all of your heroes were killed. And that's pretty much that. Matthew and I are going to have to progress through this quest before we lose. But that was one full round. Matthew and I will try to go a little bit quicker from here on out. Also during the refresh phase, the first player token switches, so it's now me. I am the first player, and now we're going to move into game round 2. So that's going to be 1 resource for every hero in play. Matthew and I each draw a card. I'm not terribly impressed with what I got, but I don't have any resource phase actions. I'll move into planning. I'll go ahead and use my Steward of Gondor to add 2 resources to Eowyn, because I've got the first player token. I'm going to be acting first, and I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to strip a single point of damage off of Aragorn, who's rather wounded, and therefore any resources on him are a bit of a liability, and I'm going to put into play a copy of Snowborn Scout. It's got a response where when it enters play, I choose a location and put a progress token on it. So I'm going to go ahead and put a token on this Mountains of Mirkwood here. And that is going to be it for me. How about you, Matthew?
I've got quite a few things in my hand. It's kind of hard to know exactly what I want to do. I do think I'm going to put a Dwarven Axe on Gimli.
Okay, so he's attack value 7 right now because he's a dwarf.
Mm-hmm. And then just because I might need a defender of some sort, because Gimli now, since he's attacking for so much, I really don't want to defend with him,
right.
I'm going to play an Erebor Hammersmith.
Right, and that's kind of something that becomes more and more important as this game goes on, is you are kind of stuck between which characters do you want to do what with. Like, Gimli can commit to the quest to contribute to willpower, but if he does that, he is not going to be ready during combat to attack for a total of 7. And the same thing goes with Legolas, who can make quest progress through killing enemies. So Matthew threw out that Erebor Hammersmith, which its ability doesn't have any attachments, to key off off of, and I put out this Snowborn Scout, so these can defend. They're probably going to die, but that means that our heroes are not going to die, because if a hero dies, you're gaining one fewer resource each and every turn, and if your heroes are dying, you're able to put fewer cards into play, and things are going to go all the way bad relatively quickly. But I suppose that's going to be planning for both of us. Matthew, let's move ahead to questing. I think this time I'm going to do the same thing as before. Note that because the first player has to commit their characters to the quest first, when I use Theodrid here to give Aragorn a resource again, the only characters commit to the quest are my own. So none of Matthew's characters are going to be eligible for Theodrid's effect here. Matthew could have used Barovor to have me draw a couple of cards during planning. Maybe that would have been a good idea, but let's kind of see how things go and just move on from there. Just like before, I'm going to ready Aragorn, and I'm going to send a total of 7 to the quest again. And I think I want to leave my Wandering Toque open just to play it safe. And how about you, Matthew? What are you sending?
Well, I didn't give you any cards because I plan to use her to go to the quest, so I'm going to send a lowly 2.
Okay, well, that still works. We've got 9 versus 2. We're only going to be revealing a couple encounter cards. So we've commit our characters to the quest. Let's go ahead and do staging. So encounter card number 1 is going to be another location. It's the Enchanted Stream. While it is the active location, players cannot draw cards. That's pretty nasty, so we'll probably try to clear that out relatively quickly. Encounter card number 2 is going to be a copy of King Spider. So each player must choose and exhaust one character he controls.
Yikes.
So the first player has to exhaust first, and because we know how many cards we're staging, Matthew and I can say, okay, there's a King Spider coming off the encounter deck. It's going to be engaging with one of us because its engagement cost is 20 relative to my threat of 30, Matthew's threat of 31. So we can exhaust characters that are kind of going to be irrelevant. So what I think I'm going to do is I'm going to exhaust my Wandering Toque. And what about you, Matthew?
Gosh, this is actually a tough decision. I think I'm going to exhaust Legolas, though.
I would recommend against doing that if you don't mind. Yeah. Why don't you get rid of your either your Hammersmith or Gimli? I would really appreciate being able to take this King Spider this round.
You want to take it?
Because I would love to take it. I've got a card that I would love to to use.
All right. If that's the case, then I will do the Hammersmith.
Sure. Just because, note, viewers, the Erebor Hammersmith isn't contributing anything, but so long as Legolas participates in an attack that destroys an enemy, we're going to be gaining 3 progress here. So, that is it. Staging is complete. We're up against a total of 6 threats. We've sent a total of 9, I believe, so 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 to the quest. We're going to be 1 shy of completing this quest phase, unless Matthew spends, like, do you have any kind of crappy cards you could discard to make sure that we can boost Eowyn's willpower up by 1?
I'll pitch a copy of Swift Strike.
All right, very conditional card, but that means Matthew is sending a total of 2. I'm sending Eowyn for 5, so 7, 8, 9, 10. 10 minus 6 is, of course, going to be 4, and that means we've completed our quest phase here, Flies and Spiders. We progress to quest phase 2A. It only has flavor text, so we move on to phase 2B, and it says 4. First, when you defeat this stage, proceed to one of the 2 A Chosen Path stages at random. So, let's go ahead and just kind of move on with our lives. I suppose after the quest phase, now that we've resolved the quest, we can travel to a location. We could do Enchanted Stream, which we'll be able to get rid of with Legolas, or we can do Mountains of Mirkwood, which we'll also get rid of, but we'll have to reveal a card off the top of the encounter deck, but when it leaves play, we can kind of search the top of our deck for cards. Personally, I vote for the Enchanted Stream.
Sounds good to me.
All right, so let's go ahead and move the enchanted stream to the active location. We're kind of going to be left with an awkward number of quest points, but I suppose that's okay. After we do the travel phase, we're going to be moving to the engagement phase. I'm the first player. I'm going to say that Matthew passes on his optional engagement, and we'll just do engagement checks. My threat's 30, engagement cost is 20, so it comes down and engages with me. At the beginning of the combat phase, it gains a shadow card, and it is going to be attacking. All right. So I'm going to declare my Snowborn Scout as the defender. I'm going to go ahead and flip the shadow card here, and this is no shadow card whatsoever. This is a big, beefy enemy, and nice. Do note that shadow cards end up being discarded. It's like, pretend it's not an enemy, it's not a location, it's not a treachery, it's just nothing at all. If this enemy were to come into play in the very bottom right, it's got victory points, and that means that when you destroy that enemy, it's so powerful that instead of being added to the discard pile of the encounter deck where you might be able to face it again, it's instead added to something called a victory display. It's like you're removed from the game pile. Some players care about score. Matthew and I do not. Nope. But it's a largely arbitrary kind of, you know, it's nice in theory, but kind of poorly executed thing. Victory points contribute to your score, but if there's anything I can recommend, it's don't keep score. So my Snowborn Scout subtracts 1 defense from the attack of 3, but it's going to end up taking 2 points of damage. The Snowborn Scout is destroyed. But I'm going to go ahead and spend 1 leadership resource for this card, a Valiant Sacrifice. So after an ally card leaves play, the card's controller draws 2 cards. So I'm going to go ahead and draw a couple of cards. I got some awesome stuff. I'm going to go ahead and discard that. Matthew doesn't have any enemies engaged with him, so we don't have to resolve any of his defenses. And now, as the first player, I'm going to have the first opportunity to attack. So, Matthew, if you wouldn't mind once again joining me.
Sure. Aragorn. And now I understand why you wanted to defend that attack.
Yeah. Right, exactly. I wanted to dig for some cards that I unfortunately did not manage to get. But Legolas plus Aragorn are going to be a total of 6 points of damage. That's going to be 5 after defense strength on the King Spider. King Spider is going to be destroyed. Legolas, his ability is going to trigger, and Matthew gets to do this in the order that benefits him most. So Legolas and the Blade of Gondolin both proc or process off of this effect, but he's going to use Legolas' ability first to add 2 points to Enchanted Stream. It's explored, and then that Blade of Gondolin triggers, and that's going to be a single point out of the 2 required points on Fork in the Road.
Yeah.
So, that's combat, and I suppose with that said, are you ready for another refresh phase?
Let's do it.
All right, so Control R, Matthew and I both gain a threat. All of our characters are no longer exhausted. The first player token bounces back to Matthew. We're going to go to, I believe it's round 3, our resource phase. We each draw a card. We're each going to add a resource to each of our characters. And now, Matthew, what are you going to do for planning?
That is a good question.
Right. So you and I both know how this quest goes. We've played Passage Through Mirkwood a time or two. I think it's only fair that Matthew and I go to the quest phase that is the more difficult of the two.
That would be fun.
Yeah. So instead of being random, we'll just do the one that results in us fighting a big scary boss monster. So Matthew and I both know that all we have to do is make a single point of quest progress in order to fight the boss. So, knowing that, what are you going to do?
All I'm going to do is play the Horn of Gondor. I wish I would have had it last round. I would have gotten a resource, but that's it for me.
Okay, so a couple of different things here. The Horn of Gondor says restricted, just below the traits, where it reads item and artifact. Dwarven Axe is also restricted, and if you think of it like a hero only has 2 hands, you can only have 2 restricted attachments. So imagine Gimli here dual-wielding a Dwarven Axe and a Horn of Gondor. Also, next to Horn of Gondor, there's a symbol that is the unique symbol. That indicates that you can only have one Horn of Gondor on the tabletop at any given time. Just like every hero has that unique symbol next to their name, you can only have one card of that name in play at a time, and that's among all players. As our card pool expands, because again, this LCG has been out for 5 years now, we eventually see different versions of the same heroes that belong to different spheres of influence. We see ally versions of the same characters, so I could not play an ally version of Legolas if Matthew has the hero version of Legolas on the table. But all you're going to do is that Horn of Gondor, sir?
Yep, that's it.
Okay, so for me, I wish that there was more I could do, but I'm a little bit limited. I think I want to keep as many characters as possible ready. I guess I wouldn't mind. I've got so many spirit resources. Matthew, do you want to use Barovor to have me draw a couple of cards? I feel like I've got a lot of resources and nothing really great to spend them on.
I sure don't, but since you asked nicely, go ahead and take some cards.
All right, well, thank you so much. So I'm going to go ahead and draw a couple of cards. I did get something that I was looking for. I'm going to go ahead and trigger my Steward of Gondor to add another two resources to Eowyn here, and I'm going to subtract four resources from her to do a copy of Northern Tracker.
Ooh.
This is another one of those most powerful cards in the core set. It's only got one willpower strength, but it's two attack, two defense, and three hit points, and after it commits to a quest, you can place a progress token on each location in the staging area. Because you can only have one active location at a time, if you're playing a three or four player game, you can, I'm sure, envision the staging area being very full of locations and not a lot of convenient ways to deal with them. But between Snowborn Scout, between a lot of different effects, this will hopefully allow for us to get rid of locations, and I think that Matthew and I should hopefully be able to finish this quest without too much trouble here. I think I might do some neat stuff just for flair, and I guess that is going to be my planning. So let's go ahead and move on to the quest phase. Matthew, it's going to be up to you to commit characters to the quest, and are you going to be sending any?
I'm actually not. Hopefully you can handle questing this turn.
Yes, I believe I've got it covered. So here's what I'm going to do. First of all, I'm going to send three of my characters to the quest. I'm going to add one resource to Aragorn, just as I've done time and time before. And I'm going to use Theodred to give Aragorn a resource, and then I'm going to use Aragorn's ability to spend a resource to ready him so that he can attack for this mad dash to the end. Because Matthew and I are going to choose the harder quest resolution option, the most difficult final quest phase, we know that we're going to have to fight a big boss monster. So I've got three characters commit to the quest. Let's see here. I think at some point I inadvertently pulled a point of damage off of Aragorn, but I'm going to remove a resource from Aragorn now, and I'm going to play a card called Sneak Attack. So it says, put an ally into play from your hand. At the end of the phase, if that ally is still in play, return it to your hand. So here is what I'm going to do. I'm going to play Faramir through this Sneak Attack, and he's got an action where I can exhaust him and choose a player. Each character controlled by that player gets plus one willpower until the end of the phase. So what I think I'm going to do is I'm going to choose myself, and I'll just have all of my characters gain plus one willpower until the end of the phase. And for some reason, I can't trigger all of them. But I'm also going to spend one resource off of Theodred, and I'm going to play Ever Vigilant, which is choose and ready an ally card. So I'm going to get rid of that sneak attack. I'll get rid of Ever Vigilant. I'm going to ready Faramir. And then I'm going to go ahead and exhaust him a second time. so that all of my characters currently have 2 willpower.
Wow.
And I think I'm just good with that. So Aragorn is commit to the quest for 4. Theodred is commit to the quest for a total of 7. And Eowyn is commit to the quest, which brings it to a total of 13. And I think I'm good with that. So are we ready for staging?
Let's do it.
All right, so encounter card number 1 is going to be a location. It is the Great Forest Web. We each have to exhaust a hero to travel there. If we don't pull any enemies, then why not? Encounter card number 2 is going to be another location. It is the Necromancer's Pass. So this isn't a lot of quest points, but it is 3 threat against us. Note that I didn't commit my Northern Tracker to the quest. His ability is only in response to when he's commit to the quest. It would not have affected these 2 locations, and because he's got an attack value of 2, I wanted to make sure that he remains ready, just so I can kind of pull off some shenanigans with him. But we've got a total of 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 threat against us. That means we're going to make a total of 6 progress, which puts us at 7 out of 2 quest points. Matthew and I are going to move on to quest phase 3A, and we're supposed to choose one of them at random. I'm randomly going to choose the top quest phase 3A. Oh my gosh, wouldn't you know it? It's the hard one. It's no quest points to pass it, but the players must find and defeat Ungoliant spawn to win the game. This is when revealed, each player must search the encounter deck and discard pile for 1 spider card of his choice and add it to the staging area. So, Matthew and I are going to go ahead and look at the encounter deck, and I'm going to choose a copy of Ungoliant Spawn so we can get this tutorial over with, and then I'm going to choose a generally kind of inoffensive spider. So, Ungoliant Spawn, let's see, it's added to the staging area. So I'm going to add our boss to the staging area, I'll talk about it in just a moment, and then another spider, I think I want to choose the King Spider is a little bit squishier than is the Old Forest Spider. So I've got those in the staging area. Just for the sake of discussion, if Matthew and I would have pulled this card during the quest phase, it's the Necromancer's Reach. It's a treachery, and it would have dealt 1 point of damage to each exhausted character. So it would have dealt damage to Faramir, but he's going to return to my hand at the end of the phase. That wouldn't have been a big deal. It would have dealt damage to Eowyn and Theodred, but it would not have dealt damage to Aragorn, because even though he was commit to the quest, he was not exhausted. So I'm going to go ahead and close and shuffle the encounter deck. Of course, Barovor would have also taken a point of damage. And as we get ready for combat here, do note, Matthew, that I've got 2 shadow effect cancellation cards in my hand.
Okay.
And if we would have seen that Necromancer's Reach, I've also got a cancel when revealed effect card in my hand. So we'd have been fine regardless. But for the travel phase, it's not going to matter too much. But let's see here. I guess Matthew, first of all, is the first player. I don't think it would be a good idea for him to discard cards at random. I don't really think we want to exhaust our heroes. All we have to do is kill Ungoliant Spawn to win the game, so why don't we go ahead and not travel this round, and let's just engage our enemies. So, as soon as the quest phase is done, Faramir bounces back to my hand, not Matthew's hand, my bad. We move to the encounter phase. So, Matthew, you're the first player, but do you want to optionally engage Ungoliant Spawn?
I would love to take Ungoliant Spawn.
All right. But note that its engagement costs 32. Matthew is threat 32, so he'd have to deal with it regardless. And for me, I think I will go ahead and optionally engage the King Spider just so Matthew doesn't have all the glory here.
Nice.
Yeah, so that is the encounter phase. There's just locations left. And now we're going to go into combat. So Matthew, you're the first player. We've got to do a shadow card for each of these enemies, starting with first player and then me. What do you want to do about Ungoliant Spawn in regard to defending?
Bam!
All right. So, Feint, very popular, very powerful card. You choose an enemy engaged with a player. That enemy cannot attack that player this phase. Pretty simple, Ungoliant Spawn. It's a 5 attack value, 2 defense, 9 hit point monster. And all of a sudden, it cannot really do any attacking whatsoever. So, it's not going to be harassing Matthew this round. We've got no attacking enemies for him. We're going to move to me. The King Spider is going to be attacking. I'm going to go ahead and declare my Northern Tracker as the defender because it's got 2 defense strength. I'm going to go ahead and flip the shadow card. There's no shadow effect, so it's going to be 1 point of damage dealt to my tracker, and I think it's fine to stomach that effect there. So, I was kind of hoping this would be the last phase. Maybe that's not going to be the case. But, Matthew, now it's going to be your turn to deal out attacks in return. And what are you going to do?
Okay, well, Gimli can strike 4, 5, 6, 7.
Right.
Legolas makes it 10. And just for fun, let's throw in the Hammersmith for 11.
Right. So I very much appreciate your being able to conjure up a total of 11 attack here. So that's going to be 11 attack minus 2 defense is going to be a total of 9 hit points. That's going to be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Once again, those elementary mathematics skills are very important. That is going to be a destroyed enemy. And I guess before Matthew and I finish up the scenario here, note that this quest card said each player must search the encounter deck and discard pile and add it to the staging area, because it did not say when, it did not say to reveal that card. We did not trigger this when revealed effect for the Ungoliant Spawn or for this King Spider. So, It's got 9 damage, it's got 9 hit points, it is going to be destroyed, its shadow card is going to be discarded ineffectually, but god, what a nasty shadow effect. 1 damage to each character the defending player controls, or again, like I said, undefended attacks are worse, 2 damage if undefended. That is a total nightmare, but Matthew gets to proc Legolas and the Blade of Gondolin, and that is going to be 3 quest points out of 0. The players must find and defeat Ungoliant Spawn to win this game. Last time I checked, Ungoliant Spawn is defeated, so I guess that is victory over Passage Through Mirkwood. So, Matthew, any overall thoughts on how this game went?
Well, thank goodness for that Airborne Hammersmith giving me that 11th point of damage.
Yeah.
But, it's a fun game. There's lots of rules, lots of intricacies. When you can play things, when there are action windows. But this was a super fun playthrough. We got to see a lot of variety of effects, which was fun. And hopefully it was helpful for those of you learning the game.
Yeah, I don't think this could have gone too much better. I suppose we didn't see the biggest diversity of encounter cards.
Right.
We didn't see the Dol Guldur Beastmaster that when it attacks, it gets 2 shadow cards, which increases the likelihood of it doing something nasty. We didn't really see any treacheries at all, but there's some nasty effects, like each enemy in each location in the staging area gets 1 threat.
Right.
We didn't see any kind of surge or doomed encounter card keywords. Like doomed is a keyword which causes all players to increase their threat. If an encounter card has the surge keyword, after you reveal it and you resolve its ability, you draw another encounter card in addition to it. So this was a very interesting playthrough. I think just a trend or pattern that becomes evident as we play through more and more expansions is that the encounter decks get smaller and more consistent with time, so there are fewer single copy cards. Like we saw Ungoliant Spawn and Chieftain Ooftok, there's some like Black Forest Bats and some other enemies that are kind of cute, but the encounter deck doesn't really have an opportunity to combo off of itself. But I think this game went reasonably well. If it would have been stretched out, this Northern Tracker would have been great to put a lot of progress onto these locations, clear them the round after next in mass, like 3 at a time, and I'd have been able to handily kill off this King Spider, and I chose it as opposed to the old Forest Spider just because I knew that I would be able to bring 4 attack value to bear. So Matthew and I are definitely power gamers. We'd like to think of ourselves as highly efficient players. I think this match went well, and I could scarcely be more happy to have Matthew back with me, even if in this tutorial video I did the vast majority of the jabbering. So I suppose we may as well end it here. I'll just say thank you once again for watching. A tremendous thanks to Matthew for joining me again for this tutorial video. And as we alluded to, the progression series is back. It's a complete reboot, re-envisioning, and restart of the series from the very beginning, starting with the core set and then moving rapidly therefrom, going through our first cycle of adventure packs, all of our deluxe expansions, our saga expansions, and of course, our print-on-demand scenarios and nightmare decks. It's going to be great evaluating all of our old cards, playing through all of our old quests and scenarios up until we reach the very most current and contemporary expansion content. So, Matthew, before I say my outro spiel, why don't you plug one last time your podcast?
For more information, lots of great discussion on the show. Yes, please check out my podcast, The Gray Company Podcast. You can find us on iTunes. Our website is graycompanypodcast.com. That's gray with an E, not an A. You can also find us on Facebook, where there's a lots of discussion. We post lots of fun articles, and so it's a great community to join. So I hope you will not only subscribe to our progression series videos, but also check out The Gray Company Podcast.
Well, I suppose I'll just conclude things by saying thank you once again for checking out this first piece of Lord of the Rings living card game content on the Hive Tyrant channel. If you enjoyed this video, do hit that like button if you want to see more LOTR LCG content. And of course, who would want to miss the first upcoming episode of the LOTR LCG progression series? So be sure to hit that subscribe button. If you want to get in touch with me, I'm facebook.com/TheHiveTyrant. On Twitter, I'm the_Hive_Tyrant. And if you ever feel any inclination whatsoever to help contribute to the progression series, to contribute to my LOTR LCG content production endeavors, I would be absolutely honored were you to make a small contribution to my Patreon. But thank you once again for watching, and as always, be sure to check back in again soon for much more LOTR LCG content to come.